Okay, for this week, we're actually looking at the novel to help us better analyze social problems. And this novel was recommended to me by actually quite a few people as being something that might be good for all of us to read together. So this is the first time I'm reading it, so I'll be reading it along with you. And man, were they right. From the very beginning, just a couple pages in even, it gets right down to some of the core issues within US government. So I just want to go over a couple of those right now as briefly as I possibly can and start to help you understand something we're going to practice called the analogy. So analogy is just when you compare two things. And in that example, I think what was interesting is how the author uses fire as an example, and I use that in some of the presentations in this class. So that might be one kind of way you think about an analogy is how do you compare fire in one situation, say like heating your home, right? Or in another situation where you're burning down a building, right? So that's the kind of comparison that we're thinking of at the simplest level. So the way that we want to use analogy here is in power, right? And so role power. What is the difference in the power of the daughter versus the power of the father? And I want you to think about that throughout the story. And we want to think about that for a couple of reasons. One of the reasons is that the main assumption within American government, if you really think about it carefully, is when folks say founding fathers. So I want to play a lot with that concept of the father. What does a government designed by fathers, for fathers, and with fathers, by fathers, right? What does that really mean? And then let's take that opposite position, especially as it's in the novel, of the daughter. What are the roles and responsibilities of the daughter? What does the daughter give up in that relationship? And what are the weak points in that power? Where does the daughter resist the authority or the rules and norms of the father? So right off the bat, you'll see in this book, there's a lot about religion. And we want to kind of unpack some of that in the class. What is the role of religion in politics? Thomas Jefferson argues under nature's God that all men are created equal. What does it mean to believe in nature's God? Some of the early settlers in the Northeast in the United States were Calvinistic Puritans. So what does it mean to believe in predestination? And what does that mean about setting up a government? It was argued that folks in the South were immoral because they were violating rules of Christianity and things that Jesus had said by enslaving people. But then you have folks who own slaves saying, no, look at this quote from Jesus saying, if you are a slave, you're supposed to stay a slave. So they're using religion to justify enslaving other people. Fast forward to, Martin Luther King Jr., who's a Baptist minister and is using the power of the pulpit to organize in churches and to give a religious message. And he's quoting back to an early philosopher, St. Augustine. Talking about the beloved community. So there's a lot going on with religion, and we want to think about how religion constitutes certain behaviors, and then also how people respond to religion in their behavior within government and as, citizens and residents. Then we want to think about economy, and notice in this first reading, the stepmom is kind of trying to give a lesson here about the comparison between the lights and the stars, right? And that she misses the city lights. So something that I think we all take for granted. And having walked through Times Square at the very beginning of the pandemic, it was very strange, right? There's no people, but there are these bright lights. So what are these bright lights for? Who are these for? And how easy we take these kind of things for granted. Also, in my own positionality, of time not being able to pay my electric bill and wondering if there was going to be light, right, when I was a struggling student, or even having the privilege of having your lights on during a snowstorm when people in Texas, right, don't have lights and heat. So, and yet maybe they could see the stars, right? So we want to think about the economy and how that kind of constitutes our roles and creates unequal power relationships. Then we kind of see how those two things lead into politics. Why would this form a mental model of being a resistor or somebody who complies? What benefits are they getting from that social structure? And how do they see politics as a struggle for power? Are they advocating for people like them? Are they thinking about people who are unlike them? And what power do they have in their role, right? Are they employed? Are they attractive, physically fit? Are they smart, dumb, right? She talks about the kids in the family, right? The dumbest being the most favored by the stepmom. So, you know, all these kind of attributions or judgments or labeling, right? How do those affect how people engage in politics? And then I really want you to start thinking about your future self, right? I'm gonna have you write a letter to your future self. And this novel is about the future, although it's eerily very similar to our recent past. How do you think politics is going to be for you in the year 2025 or the year 2030, especially as the demographics start to change in the United States? There'll be more people of color. There'll be more people of color in powerful positions. There'll be more immigrants. Sadly, there'll be more poor people. There'll be more homeless people. There'll be more children. So there's a lot of, you know, kind of unclear things about the future. And then we want to think about going back to our theories of political science and really thinking about participation. What can we predict about participation in the future? Will it be more constructive? Will we be making new things like we're having to try to do with the COVID response? Will it be more elitist, right? Will it be like the story where people have walls, right? And so they keep out poor people. And so the rich people will be separate from the poor people. Even more so than like gentrification. And then will it be more pluralistic? Will we want to encourage more participation among, you know, different diversities, whether those are economic, racial, cultural, religious, right? How are we going to construct that? Is it more likely to look like a United Nations, or is it more likely to look like the crisis in the Balkans, or even, right, the crisis in the United States, where diversity seems to be causing a problem? So we can't seem to have a multiple points of view. And then finally, we want to think about this word parsimony, where we want to, you know, you want to have the simplest theory to explain political participation so that you don't have what are called a lot of outliers, right? So in this kind of role power, you know, we want to be able to predict the moment in which she's going to start pushing up against her family's values and their norms and start to rebel, right? So we want to be able to do that with some precision, with some ability to reduce the thing that we're studying, right? The situation, the event that we're studying, to try to explain as much as we can with as few principles as we can. And I know that's a brand new concept for many of you, so we'll practice that. But I'll be looking for that in your first letter, and then I'll be kind of hoping and helping you build that up, that skill up towards the final exam in your final letter.